And I will go ahead and turn today's presentation over to my colleague, Bridgette.
Thank you, Stacy, and thank you all for taking some time out of your day to join us as I discuss our college and career paths and planning. My name again is Bridgette Yee McIntyre, and I am the Director of Integrated Programs. I've been at CTY for 12 years, and I spent 10 years before that, I know I'm aging myself, but 10 years before that in a selective college admissions environment. So this is a topic that is very near and dear to my heart, and I love talking about planning your college application process and planning for your future careers. So I'll go ahead and get started. I want to let you know that a lot of what we've learned over the past years is that there's just several ways that you can create a path to success in college and in your career. So what I'd like to do today is just share some tips that I've learned along the way that we've shared with other families that have found successful, so you can navigate the twists and turns that you're going to encounter while on the path to success. So we'll talk a little bit about some of the myths, just a few of the many, many myths that are going around and constantly are changing, but have similar themes as we talk about the college admissions process and preparing for careers and what we know about the myths and maybe debunk them a little bit and how you can use CTY as a resource to support yourself and your family as you're going through these processes, and share a few final thoughts. So I've been giving presentations to families for about 20 years, and about half that time working in admissions, like I said, and working at CTY. So what I've learned, it's best to talk quickly to get through the presentation and the slides, and then leave a lot of time for questions and answers so I can tell you what you want to hear. So I'll just share a few things here. There's a lot of things that I won't be able to touch on, but I want to make sure I'm leaving a lot of time for questions and answers so we can talk about what you want to talk about. So we'll go ahead and get started. So a few of the myths that I want to touch on today. There's one perfect college or job out there for you, and the bigger the name, the better the school, the bigger the company, the better the school, the bigger the paycheck, the better the job, to do a little bit of everything, to be good at all of it. And things are just a numbers game, whether it's about more is better and applying to more jobs, more colleges, more universities, or maybe breaking down the admissions process to just numbers, that it's all about who has the best GPA, the most AP classes, the best IB curriculum, and the highest SAT or ACT score. And with enough research, you can make yourself the ideal candidate. So those are some of the things we'll try to break down today. So what we know with this first myth, let's tackle that one. The idea of a perfect fit, whether it's a college or a career or a job, is really dated. First, with close to 3,000 four-year degree granting institutions, there's going to be several schools that are going to give you opportunities to thrive. We have an ever-changing job market, and we can all agree that COVID, the pandemic changed our lives and our job market. So many of the jobs that professionals have today didn't even exist maybe 10 or even 5 years ago. New businesses, small businesses, and entrepreneurship is flourishing in our job market as well. So we really have to make sure that we are understanding that times are changing and that there are many different opportunities that are going to come across our desks or across our in our lives that are going to be great for us. So there isn't just one perfect college or one perfect career out there for you. The next myth, the bigger the name, the better the school. So while there are several universities that will be a great fit for you or your student, college rankings will still come out every year. U.S. News and World Report, Newsweek, Peterson's, Fisk Guide, Barron's Guide, all the various websites will have their own list of top colleges or best companies to work at. But what I really challenge our families to consider is, who is it that's ranking these colleges and jobs and companies, and what metrics and data are they using to measure the topness of a college or company? Many times in the university and college realm, it's the percent of alumni who give monetarily back to the university, the size of the endowment that the university has, how selective it is, their retention rate from first to second year, their standard test scores for their entering class, their graduation rates. Some of these things may be very important to you, but some of them might not. And a lot of things that these lists and different publishers don't measure is student satisfaction and student happiness on campus. How easy is it to take advantage of opportunities on a campus? What kind of support are you going to have from your professors and other instructors on campus? When you're going to highly selective schools, those opportunities might be really difficult to come by. They might have amazing opportunities, but when you're at a very competitive school, you're going to compete for those opportunities as well. So these rankings can be helpful, though. I think that it's a really great way to have a starting point for your research as you're going further into the process. But the key point is, research these schools, ask questions. It is more than common for our families to email admissions offices or various offices on college campuses to really ask the questions that are important to them to get the information that they want. And if they see that there's a school on a list of other schools that they've never heard of, a school that they're very interested in, and they're seeing that they're grouped with these other groups of schools, it might be worth checking into some of those schools, because, like I was saying in the last slide, with 3,000 four-year degree granting institutions just in the United States, we're not even talking about around the world, you're going to have a lot of things that are really great matches for you, a lot of colleges that are great matches for you. The next myth is, hold on, my notes are freezing here. The next myth is to do a little bit of everything and to be good at all of it. So what I wanted to say about this is that you really do not need to be the jack of all trades to be the ideal college applicant. You do not need to be the president of the class and the student council treasurer and have 300 hours of community service and be the captain of a sports team at your school and be the lead in the drama show or the play of the fall and the spring musical. We really want to know in colleges and in admissions what you're interested in doing, what you really care about, what you enjoy, and that goes and rings true for your career opportunities as well when you're interviewing. What kind of person are going to be in the workforce? How are you going to contribute to your work community? How are you going to contribute to the campus? So, my Stacey, I'm not sure if you are able to share your screen because mine just froze.
Sure. Bridgette, go ahead and unshare.
Okay. Okay, so I think we were on. It's a numbers game. So the next thing I wanted to address, the numbers game. What I mentioned in the beginning of the presentation about applying to more schools, I think a lot of families get an idea that because the process is so competitive that you need to apply to several colleges and universities to give yourself the best chance to get in. And what we're really finding on the admission side of things is that actually more likely that the more schools you apply to, you're going to start making some careless errors and mistakes because you have so much to keep track of, so many things that you need to do to make sure those applications are complete, that we do recommend that you are going to make a concise list. I'm not saying you apply to one school or two or three, but you can narrow down your list to make it manageable. Because remember, if you are going to apply to 20 different schools, you have to write 20 different essays. You have to write 20 short response answers on 20 different student contract agreements and how you're going to be a good citizen on campus. And schools and colleges are going to look for specific things about their school that they want to read in your short responses. And if you have 20 of them, you're going to spend a lot of time writing. And one of the pet peeves that admissions officers will share over and over again are careless errors, especially the ones that are when students are applying to so many colleges that they lose track of which college they're writing about. And we read applications for other schools, or we read essays that mention other schools. Like, that's why I really want to be at Georgetown University. But we don't work at Georgetown, we work at Johns Hopkins. So we want to make sure that you're paying attention and paying attention to detail. And the more applications that you're doing and responsible for, the more likely you're going to have some of those careless errors. Essays and interviews are also important. So when our schools are starting to become more commonly test blind or test optional with our SAT or ACT tests, the essays become more important. So having to write 20 essays is not going to allow you to really focus and put forth your best work. So we really want to make sure that you're not overexerting yourself and you're really present in your high school career. And also with the numbers, we're talking about the number of activities, like I mentioned in my last slide, the number of AP courses you're taking. I think the idea is that if you have the most APs and the most competitive curriculum, you will be the best candidate. But really what ends up happening with a lot of our students is they will take AP courses and maybe subjects they're not really strong in, and they spend so much time struggling or just trying to make it through that AP course. Maybe you're not a great math person, you're an amazing writer, but you're taking AP Calc BC. So you're working so hard just to keep your grades up and to keep up with your calculus class that all of your other courses, you don't enjoy them anymore, you don't enjoy school anymore, and you start to fall behind in the other courses that you really are passionate about. So focus on what you're good at and play to your strengths and find that balance. The next myth: with enough research, you can be the ideal candidate. And I think, of course, research is important, so don't get me wrong on that. But what I want to talk about is the idea that a lot of families or students think that they can mold themselves into the perfect candidate. If you learn enough about a school and you see that they really are big fans of students who do community service, so you do as much community service as possible to look like you are going to fit in with what you are seeing on a website or hearing in a college presentation about a school. Or you find out that they really need more students who are interested in the sciences. So you say, well, I'm going to be a biology major, when really that might not be the ideal college major path for you. So make a really diverse list of schools that have schools that are maybe a reach, those that are probably under 20% admit rates, where even though you are a very strong candidate and you would be successful at that school, 80% of the students do not get into that school. So those are reach schools. And then you have other schools where it's a really good target for you. It's a really great fit. You would thrive there. You'd be really successful. And you have a pretty decent chance of getting into that school. So the other idea that I want to sort of get rid of, because it's a bit outdated, is the idea of being a well-rounded student. Students think that they have to be everything to everyone and have a little bit of everything in their repertoire on their resume to be the ideal student. But really, colleges aren't interested in well-rounded students as much as they are interested in building a well-rounded class. So they don't want a class full of leaders, a class full of really strong science, biology, chemistry majors. They want people who have interest in the arts and in the sciences and in math and in English and in the performing arts, and who are leaders and who are also great project managers. And the more diverse their class is, the more benefit there is to the entire school. So what I'm encouraging you to do is to be sticky, to stick out, not to be rounded, but to be sticky and make yourself and your uniqueness known in the college application process. Same thing with college, with career and interviewing. The more that you're going to stick out and show your uniqueness, the more appealing I think you will be to colleges as you're applying and to companies as you are applying for jobs. So the other part, being in control. That's what I meant by coming up with a really diverse list of schools. So you can sort of take control, and you know that there's going to be some schools where you'll do everything you can and then you kind of leave it to the fates as far as if you are one of that 20% that is admitted to the university. But then you have more control over the rest of your list, where you have schools that you are likely to be admitted to. They have a little less selective admit rate, but you will thrive and you will be successful. And next slide. I'm glad I wrote my notes down. So just a few tips and strategies that I'm hoping were a recurring theme through this quick talk. To be present, to make sure if you're taking all of your time to write essays and fill out applications, you're going to miss your last one and a half or one year of high school or secondary school. So make sure you're present. Same thing with college. It's not just a footstep onto your career. It's 4 years where you can gain amazing skills and have a great toolbox of skills that you can use in the workforce. But if you spend so much time worrying about what comes next, you're not being really present, and you're not going to get those years back, as we all know. Being sticky, I just mentioned that, like trying to stick out, make sure that your uniqueness is showing through by doing what you enjoy. And you don't have to be the best at what you enjoy doing. You don't have to be the leader or win all of the awards, but just showing what types of things you like to do, showing your personality is a benefit to the admissions and application process. One other tip that I think that a lot of students have said has been helpful: take notes. Take notes in your high school career and in your college career. This will allow you to sort of jot some things down as you're thinking about them in the moment. You don't have to flush them out, but it'll allow you to be present in the moment and say, you know, this is a really interesting situation that I just went through, where I overcame some obstacles, or I was very successful at something, or I was really proud of a group project that I worked on, or there's some sort of accolade that you want. Note it. Write it down, or even funny stories, things that you think would be entertaining to tell other people later on. And you can go back to that notebook when it's time to write your college essays and you have a foundation of examples and stories and things that have happened. You don't have to write it all out, like I said, but just jot it down so you remember it. And then you'll have a foundation to start from when you sit down to write your college essays. Same thing with interviews. There's been 10 years that I've been sitting on interview committees for job searches, and there's good interviews and then there's great interviews. Good interviewers will answer questions, they'll answer them fully, and that's it. Great interviews will answer the question fully and give examples from their life, real-time examples, real-life examples of how they have embodied the question, or how they've shown how they work well in groups, or how they've taken leadership or ownership over something, or how they've overcome a struggle and gone through a difficult situation. Instead of just saying, yes, I'm very good at that, you can actually give examples if you have been taking those great notes throughout your 4 years in college and 4 years in high school. So hopefully that's helpful. Just one final thought that I wanted to share. Well, first I want to talk a little bit about on the next slide why CTY is really a good resource for college and career planning. And I know, yes, I work at CTY. Obviously, we're going to promote our programs, but I wanted to say why I think these are important for the college and career planning process. These courses that you can take with CTY, whether they be online or in person, you have an opportunity to meet your peers, to meet others who have the same intellectual interests that you have. And it also gives you exposure to advanced curricula and advanced material that you would not have an opportunity to have exposure to in high school. So the benefit of that is also that you're in a low stakes environment. So you can take fast-paced chemistry for high school students, even though maybe you're an eighth grader, and you may find out that this is not a good fit for you, that chemistry is not your thing, that you thought it would be really interesting, but you go to our summer program or take one of our online courses and figure out this just isn't interesting to you, or you're not very skilled at the chemistry classes and the chemistry material. But you find that out and it's a low stakes environment where it's not going to end up on your transcript, or it's not a college course that you have to get a grade in. So I think it's really beneficial to explore through CTY. And we also have other sessions and programs like this. I know Stacy mentioned earlier that we do have Wellness Wednesdays. We also have other career development workshops where you can hear from different career executives who are CTY alumni or have CTY connections, and sometimes their parents or guardians, and they can share their experiences in the workforce. So that can give you some interesting perspectives on how to plan for your future. So that is what I wanted to share with you quickly today. I'm sorry if it felt a little jolted when I lost all of my notes, but for any of those programs at CTY, we do have information for you here on the website. If you're already part of CTY, you would just go to the website without the /start. Or if you're interested in joining and having more opportunities available to you, you can start joining CTY now. If you have questions about some of the resources that we have and the courses that we offer, please reach out to the CTY enrollment officers and they will help guide you and give you suggestions on courses to take based on your interests and your goals. So you can email them right there. And I wanted to thank everybody for joining us, and we'll do some Q&A now.